Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the IMSC Algebraic Combinatorics Seminar. It's a great pleasure to have Anupam Singh of IISER Pune. He's going to talk about asymptotics of powers in finite reductive groups. Anupam, please.
Thank you, Amri. I hope everybody can hear me. Since there are not many people, you can ask questions whenever you want. It's not too much of a problem that way. Thank you for inviting me in this series of talks. So I'll go on and talk about this asymptotics of powers in finite reductive groups. I will begin with talking about a little bit of background of this this topic. There have been a lot of work in this direction, what is called word maps and things like that, over the last couple of decades. So I'll try to first introduce that a little bit and kind of as a motivation. And then I will come towards the end on this topic, which we have been working in last few years. Let me begin with defining what is a word map. I also have given these talks over like last 1 or 2 years, several places. So some of you might have heard part of it. So my apology to those people. So let me begin with defining what is a word map. So let's take a finite group G. G is a finite group. A word W, is supposed to be an element of the free group FD. So let's say free group FD is in D variables, and I will call the variable variables X1, X2, XD. Yeah, and then for example, word will look like X1, X2, XD, or you know, it can have some of the variables and some powers, right? And where the powers are integers. So this is general definition of a word, word in D variables. And what is a word map? So given a group and given a word, I can define a map, and this map will take D elements from G. So this is a map from G to power D to G, because there are D variables, and it just substitutes the elements of the group. Yeah, so you can take D elements of the group G and substitute in the variable. It will give you another element of G, and that is the value at that point. And this will define a map from G to power D to G. So such maps are called word map. And just for the definition's sake, I'll say that W is non-trivial. So now onwards, I will refer word map simply as a W. So the W is said to be non-trivial if the image is non-trivial. It's more than identity. Yeah. So the definition is clear, I hope, to everybody. I'll just pause for a second here, because you know, if somebody sees the definition for the first time, it is a bit. I should also point out here that I am not looking at the image WG. So this image WG. So I'm not looking at this as a subgroup generated by the image. It's just the set. It's not a subgroup of G. So WG is simply a subset of G. It's not a subgroup. It may not be subgroup. I'm not claiming that take the subgroup generated by the set WG. So that's an important difference here. Okay, so now let's move on. So what are the broad questions in this subject? The broad questions are as follows. The general question, first question will be to ask how big is the image. So I will simply denote WG for the image of this W. So W of G to power D, I'll just simply denote it by W of G. It's a subset of G. It may not be a subgroup. In general, it's just a subset. So we want to understand how big is that. So for example, you can ask like whether it's always surjective, or at least for particular W, is it surjective? Then you can ask more general question that if I look at the subgroup generated by WG with respect to WG, what is the width of that? Like how many elements from WG you need to have to write every element of this subgroup? I'll come back to this. And this is concept. Okay, I have said here, in fact, for example, you can think of this as can you determine the diameter of the Kelly graph of G with respect to the set WG when W is surjective? So in this case, WG, you are assuming that it generates the whole group. And then you want to know how many elements of that set you require to get to every element of G. So if you think in the Kelly graph term, it's something like diameter, or, you know, that's what it reflects. And more generally, like if it is not surjective, you can ask this question that how big is this this set? So this will be less than or equal to one. And if it is not one, how close it is to being one? So these are very broad questions, and let's look at some examples, some very basic examples, some classic examples. So here is a classic example of a word map. So just take simply the commutator, right? So you take two variable x1, x2, and the commutator map will be sending x1, x2 to x1, x2, x1 inverse, x2 inverse. And this will define a word map on any group you take. I mean, it doesn't have to be on finite, any group you can take. And then this will define a map from G cross G to G, which is called commutator map. And now this will say that I have this commutator. I mean, if usually we denote commutator by this. So this is subset of G. And you are asking whether it is surjective or not in general, like this kind of questions, or how big it is inside G, if it is not surjective, and things like that. Another example is to look at a power map. So it's simply in one variable, take any element of G, raise it to some power m. So m is given some integer, and you can say, look at the map G going to G to power m. So simply power map, I mean, you can. So these are two very basic examples and kind of classic examples. And you can take, of course, more complicated word and things like that. So let's get to some motivation that why these things are important. So first, one of the important problem is what you call Orr's conjecture. So in 1951, Orr conjectured that the commutator map is surjective for all non-abelian finite simple groups. So he said that if you have a finite simple group, non-abelian, then every element is a commutator, is a single commutator. I mean, it doesn't say that the commutator subgroup is equal to G. That is much easier to prove in general. So it says that every element is a commutator. So that was the conjecture of Orr, which in our language will mean that you want to say that if you are non-abelian finite simple group, and if you look at word map, this commutator word map, then this map is surjective. Right. So this is the example I gave. The first example, if you look at a commutator map, and if you take any non-abelian finite simple group G here, the conjecture says that these maps are supposed to be surjective. Okay. So a little bit of a story about Orr's conjecture. This conjecture is now proved in affirmative. It's positively proved now. Orr himself proved this for alternating groups in 1951 when he made this conjecture eventually. In 1961, Thomson proved it for SLM. I think he proved for even like not just finite field or more general field even. Certainly finite fields are covered. So, and in 1998, Ehlers and Gordieu proved this for all finite simple groups of Lie type. So that was like major part of the conjecture was proved in 98. However, there were some cases left, and those things are now completely proved in 2010, which is the work of Liebeck, O'Brien, Shalev, and Teeb. So this is now completely settled.
Sorry, Anupam, well, the second point you said Thomson proved it for SLM, but this conjecture is for finite simple groups.
It implies for PSLM. I mean, it is... It implies for PSLM. He proved it for PSLN. I think I just wrote SLN here.
Oh, but over finite field, you mean? Or
No, I think he proved for more general field, not just finite field.
Okay.
And finite field are also included in that paper. Okay. And Ehlers and Gordieu, there were probably like, you know, they had some condition on the some small rank that left, but those were like proved case by case or things like that. So now finally, in 2010, everything is settled. So this is this conjecture is proved now. So it means that every element in any finite simple group is a single commutator. I used to be confused. I mean, I am emphasizing single commutator because at one point of time I was very confused with this, that single commutator versus subgroup generated by commutators, right? But maybe it was just for me. Another interesting thing is what is called Waring like problem. So we all are familiar with Waring problems in number theory. And just for the sake of stating it, I just say here that if you take any k, any integer greater than 1, does there exist gk such that every natural number is a sum of gk many kth powers of natural numbers? So which you can say in another way is that if I look at x1 square plus x2 square plus x gk square, is this surjective on n? I should have said x1 to the power k, and so that 2 is a special k, it should be k here. It should have been actually x1, it should be x1 to the power k. Okay, it's making a little tricky to write. Okay, anyway, so what I meant to say here, that x1 to the power k plus 1, and you want to find gk smallest. So if k is equal to 2, you will say that whether everything is, every positive integer is sum of squares, and what is the minimal such thing, and we know that is supposed to be 4, that every integer is positive integer is sum of 4 square. So that will say that g of 2 is 4, and there are some other calculations done. For example, g of 3 is 9, g of 4 is 19, etc., etc. There is work of Balu in this subject, huge contribution, and apparently this is still not completely solved. I mean, there are a lot of cases known already that what is this exact number. I'm not an expert on this, but I just looked up Wikipedia, and this is what it says, that conjecture is supposed to be something like this. But that's a number theory problem. So why I'm trying to connect it to that, because you can ask a similar problem here for any non-commutative situation also. So this is what is called broad family of Waring-like problem. So let me state it for non-abelian finite simple and quasi-simple group. So suppose I am given some n, some positive integer, and the question is that if I look at this product x1 to the power n, x2 to the power n, xfn to the power n, we are yet to determine f of n. Is this map surjective? And so the question is twofold. First of all, does such a function f exist given n? Is this a finite number? And if it is a finite number, what is that minimal number? That will be f of n, right? So just kind of duplicating the Waring problem. So that's why it's called Waring-like problem for non-commutative situation. So you can take any group. In fact, you can ask this question. And so basically we are trying to use the word, which is the power map, x1 to the power n. And you are trying to look at its image. And you are asking that, does that image generate the subgroup? And what is the diameter with respect to that? I mean, if you are used to thinking in that terms, you can think it that way.
Excuse me. Yeah. Can you elaborate the map? What do you mean by does FN exist? So from G to that part, I don't understand the map here.
No. So F is a map. So given N, suppose N is given to be 2.
Okay.
So how many product is required to write every element of the group as a product of squares?
Okay. Okay.
So we don't know that number. That's why I'm calling it supposed to be a function of some N. So function of 2. It will be a function of 2. For example, if you look at the analogy with the number theory, every positive integer is sum of 4 square, right? That is a 4 square theorem. So yeah. You will say that the f of 2 is 4. I mean, here I call it g of 2. G of 2 is 4. Hmm. You require 4 times adding those numbers. So since we don't know whether this number even exists, that's why I'm calling it a function of n. So the question is twofold. First of all, whether such a number exists, and if it exists, then what is exactly that number? The minimal, of course, you want. Right. So that's what I have explained here. In other words, consider the set G to power n, where G is a finite simple group. So we are asking this question for finite simple group and quasi simple group, and of course you can ask it for any group. I think it doesn't matter. Does S generate G? And if it generates G, determine the width of G with respect to the set S. So that is the restating the same question which I have written here. Yeah. So I hope it is clear to everyone. So let me go back to a theorem of Borel in 1983, where he proved something like this for algebraic group. I mean, of course, he was trying to work with something else, but this can be now seen in that result can be seen in now this light. So he proved this, that if you take any simple algebraic group, and if you take any non-trivial word in D variable, D could be anything, then the word map defined by W is a dominant morphism. Which roughly speaking, that image is going to be dense in G. That's what it says. And if you know a little bit of algebraic group, or you just think of it as a topology, purely from topology point of view, or topological group point of view, then if you have a subset which is dense, that will mean that if you square that, you will get whole of the group. So that set, if you multiply with itself, you cover the whole of the group. It's just basic. You can do this with even basic topological group idea. So that will mean that for any simple algebraic group, f of k is always going to be 2. Not just f of k, in fact any word. So k means like I'm taking the word x to the power k. However, of course it implies for any word, and you can take any image. So this is like, you know, fantastic theorem. I mean, that every element can be written as product of 2 square, essentially you are saying, right? Or any 2 powers. But it is of course for simple algebraic group where you use a lot of machinery available for algebraic group and things like that. The question is that can you do something like this for finite simple groups or finite groups or some other examples? The story may not be same. We don't know that yet. So. Just to highlight that Pralay Chatterjee has a lot of work on power maps, subjectivity of power map for algebraic groups, and Steinberg and all have worked on this kind of thing. So let me come back to tell you what kind of results are known now in this subject, and there are a lot of breakthroughs. This has happened in last 20 years, and I will highlight some of those results. So let's set this notation. Suppose G, I'll denote G for a non-abelian finite simple group here on this at least couple of slides. And let's take W any non-trivial word. Okay, so the first result which was proved in 96 and 97 by like kind of two independent papers, Martinez and Gilmino 96 and Saxel and Wilson in 97, they proved that such a function f of k exists. For finite simple groups. So for finite simple group, this also means that if you take enough product, it's always surjective. That's what it means. However, of course, they did not determine exactly what is this minimal value. So the thing is to so f of k is supposed to be smallest such value, right? So then the work continued. Next breakthrough occurred in 2001, which is by Liebeck and Shalev. And this is they prove that there exists such a constant C, and they also give some bound on C, that WG of C to the power C is G. You multiply C times WG, you'll always get G. It's much more concrete than the existence. I mean, they actually get some bound on C. However, if you still think in terms of the result known for algebraic group, which is Borel's result. There it's supposed to be C, supposed to be just two. So we are not satisfied until unless we get precise value of C. And so the Shalev, the next breakthrough was Shalev in 2009, where he proved that there exists some capital N such that if order of group is bigger than N, just to say that order of G is big enough, then C is 3. You can multiply 3 times the image and you get the whole of the group G. I mean, this is amazing breakthrough. And however, there is some small condition that the order of group has to be, large enough. Maybe it may not work for very small size group. Remember, this is only for finite simple group, non-abelian finite simple group. We are not saying for any finite group. It's only for non-abelian finite simple group. The next improvement happened in 2011 by Larson, Shalev, and Teep. There exists, again, it says the large enough G, then WG square is G. So they improved 3 to 2. If you again think in the light of Borel dominance theorem, this is what was expected. I mean, I don't know whether it was expected, but it came to that essentially. And hence that Borel's theorem is very important, that the same happens over even finite simple groups. So this is amazing theorem actually. So, however, you see that here, there are some conditions that order of group has to be large enough. But these results are for any non-trivial word W on finite simple group. So basically this result here, this paper proves the varying problem for finite simple group.
So do we know how large?
There are some very rough bounds. There are some rough bounds. But there are, so I'll come to the second half of the problem where ask this question that given a fixed W, can you say that it's still like true for every element? So
but I'll is it like 10 to 500 or is it something like,
It involves 20. The structure of the group. So the bounds involve something to do with the group. So it might even become larger if we're looking at different kind of group or something like that.
So this N does not, what do you mean? So you have n is independent of the group, right?
Yes, n is independent of group. Yeah. So okay, I have not looked at exactly the value of n, but there are other kind of results which I will tell you that where you can precisely say that for every element you can do this without this condition. So that's the another aspect of looking at this problem. So here it is like some results. So if you look at, again, this is another series of paper by Larson, Shalev and Teep. For large enough G, so this is just the consequence of what I said just now, is that for large enough G, F of image is 2. And for finite simple group, and they extended it also finite quasi simple group, that you need 3, you cannot do with 2. If you are quasi simple groups. Again, can we get rid of this kind of condition large enough G? At least if you fix some word W. So let's look at those kind of results. So this is in a series of papers by Liebeck, O'Brien, Shalev and Teep. And there is another paper together with Guralnik. If you look at the acronym of this, it's called LOST, L-O-S-T. So this LOST 1, 2, 3, 4, they prove this, that every element of every finite simple group is a product of 2 square. So if you take the word map x going to x square, then you just need 2. So it's even better than the varying problem for number theory, where actually you require 4. So non-commutativity somehow plays a very crucial role here in this case. So here you don't have any condition that group has to be large enough or anything. It's for every finite simple group. And then they try to extend this. That's what the series of papers is. So every element of every finite simple group is a product of two nth powers. If n is a single prime power or product of two prime powers, this is still true. However, this is not true if you take product of three prime powers. So they have some examples also in that paper. One can look at that series of papers. Now you can ask question if there is something known for Lie groups and Shivalik groups. So there is a paper of Hui, Larson and Shalev. This is 2015. They proved similar results for some Lie groups and Shivalik groups. I just briefly state the result. There exists capital N such that if G is a classical connected real compact Lie group of rank at least N, then W of G square is G. And if you look at real or QP for a simple Shivalik group G or F, we have WG cube is G. So there are some results known even in more general setup here. Okay, so that was some brief history of the word problem. I should also point out, I think I gave somewhere reference. Yeah, I must point out if you are interested, you should look at the survey article by Shalev, which is this some results and problems in the theory of word maps. If you're interested in this kind of looking at what more is known or what precisely is known or something like that. So this is like 3-4 years back. So it has quite up to date information, detailed information about this problem. And he also gives several open problems and several conjectures in this paper, in this article. This is a survey article. So I'll refer this to the survey article again. That's why I'm just pointing you out this one. Okay, so let's move to this problem, image size. So if you look at some word map, then you are asking how big is the image, right? So we see that even for the power map, image is not generally, of course, it's not surjective generally. So mostly it is not surjective, but for finite simple group, the results you see that finitely many times if you multiply, it is enough. And you're trying to find out what is that number you want to multiply. Like it was 2 or 3, it came down to that. But the question still remains that how big is the image? So we are trying to compute the ratio of something like this. So let's look at this problem and what is known in that direction. So this is Larson and Shalev in 2009. They proved that for each non-trivial word W and epsilon greater than 0, there exists some N depending on W and epsilon. So that if N is bigger than capital N, then for alternating group, W of alternating group, image by alternating group, this is greater than 1 by N to the power 29 by 9 plus epsilon. So something very interesting number. So this can be also thought of as what is the probability of finding an element in alternating group which is in this image. So you can think from that point of view. For example, if it is a power map, let's say kth power or mth power you want to say, then what is the probability of finding an element which is k power, right? So
any ideas about upper bounds?
So of course, like it has to be less than or equal to 1, and the expected answer is, so this is what the Shalev says in his survey article, that it is expected to be closer to 1.
Okay, so then this is pretty small. Yeah.
Yeah, and that explains why multiplying twice is enough. Those subjectivity, the product of 2 square, everything is product of 2 square, because image, even though it is not surjective, it is pretty big. The number of powers, right? Number of squares. You can have some trivial map also. For example, if you are looking at finite group, then if you raise to the power order of group, then everything becomes 1. So that is the other end. But if it is non-trivial, it is big. It's not small. That's what you are trying to say here.
So non-trivial means that it is.
If it contains non-identity element, yeah. So Yeah, so we have been looking at this kind of problem. So that's why I want to give you brief history of what is known here. They also proved in the same paper, more generally, for any finite simple group of Lie type. So if you look at this, finite simple group of Lie type of rank n. So the similar result they proved. So if you take any non-trivial word W, that exists capital N, such that if G is a finite simple group of Lie type of rank small n, which is not of type An or 2An, and our order of G is bigger than capital N, then this ratio is bigger than C by N. So the N is the rank. So they relate it to rank in somehow. And where C is some absolute constant, depending on the word W. So the thing here that not of type an or 2an is not that it is not true for that. That's what Shalev conjectures, that it's just that their method did not apply for that. And then he says that the same kind of bound should be true for an or 2an too also. So this is one of the conjectures of Shalev in that the bound in this last inequality should be also true for an and 2an. So you can have a look at this. This is what you want to say for any word W. So we were looking at this problem, and for power maps we have proved this bound. And interestingly, we use different method, which is more explicit in some sense, and we actually get the value of C also here. So, for power map, but this we proved only for the power map, not for very general word map. So this is work with Alexey Galt, Amit Kulshrest, and Vadvin. If you look at the power map, let's say x to the power m, and if you look at the group PSLNQ or PSUNQ, this is group of type an and 2an, and q is odd. Then there exists some n. Such that if order of group is bigger than n, then we have this kind of bound, where we actually get some value of C, which is somewhat like,
So your result is stronger than what he said, right? You have an LNN also.
Yeah. So this is more explicit because we are looking at power word, and one has to do a lot of estimation and counting and things like that. So then we were trying to also look at, so this is me and Amit Kulshrest. We were trying to look at SL2, just the group SL2. And we were trying to think of that some of those earlier results involved that these things are true or finite field, right? Is that really necessary? I mean, one should hope that some of these results are true for any field. For example, Borel's theorem says that, for any algebraic group that is true, so the condition of field being finiteness should not be important. So we explicitly computed, this is more like a computational method we even used gap and things like that. And we have now proved this, that for every element of SL2K is a product of 2 square, just assuming characteristic is not 2. And more generally, you can try to take quaternion division algebra and look at SL1Q. But in there, you need some condition that -1 is a square in SL1Q, where Q is a quaternion division algebra. So it may not be true for all forms. That's what it indicates. But this is only for result for A1. This is also done in some other context of, so there are other conjectures involving this context, if we go back. When you are trying to say that every element of every finite simple group is a product of 2 square, and here you are saying finite simple group, if you look at SL2 or if you, instead of looking at squares, if you look at cube or some other power, then what happens, right? Fourth power, for example, what happens? That will not fall in squares and things like that. So there was some conjecture. So we also found counterexample for that and things like that, which is very explicit for SL2. Okay, so in another work, wanted to look at triangular matrices. I mean, what is the situation in the soluble group, let's say? And the first example of soluble group will come to mind is the triangular matrices. So
what did you say about that finite simple group? I mean, I assume you are leaving out abelian groups or?
Yeah, I'm always leaving out abelian group, yeah. I mean, always I mean by non-abelian finite simple group.
And for what about for small values? Of course, things will go.
I mean, if the field is very small,
A5 or something.
Yeah. So when field is very small, so the only exception will be the when it is two. So that is taken care by saying not two. Otherwise, it's fine. Probably you will say that SL2-2 or SL2-4 might be a problem, but that we are leaving out here.
Okay. No, I meant on the previous issue, every finite.
This one here, let me go back. This one you are saying.
So
every element of every finite simple group is a product of 2 squared.
Okay, so you are leaving out the abelians there, right?
Yeah, I'm leaving out abelian here. Okay. So here finite simple group, they always mean non-abelian finite simple group.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so where are we? Yeah, so this is groups of type A1. So we were talking about triangular matrices. So for triangular matrices, let's fix some notation. So T and Q is, let's say, lower triangular matrix group, invertible matrices, and U and Q is the unitriangular subgroup of this, where diagonal is 1, 1, 1. And UP minus 1 is a subgroup where, like, you know, you have a P minus 1 subdiagonal 0 and non-zeros beyond that. So that is just the notation. That's what this says here. So then, these are not difficult to compute. U and Q to the power P is always going to be inside P minus 1. So whenever you try to raise power P, P is the same P where the base prime is. So it will start making first subdiagonal, second subdiagonal, and so on, 0 up to P minus 1. So it will go inside this group here. And U and Q to power P is 1 if and only if N is less than or equal to P. And U and Q to the power P is UP minus 1 NQ if and only if N is P plus 1 and P plus 2. Sub relation between, like, you know, size of the matrix and P. So we tried to find the estimate in this case also. And the estimates are as follows. So if you look at N greater than or equal to P plus 3, which is because, of course, this will become otherwise trivial. So N greater than or equal to P plus 3, then the set U and Q to the power P is a proper generating subset of UP minus 1 NQ. So it is not equal to this. So it's not surjective. It's a proper subset, but it generates that in this case. And when Q is bigger than N minus P minus 1, then this is supposed to be 1 by 3, bigger than 1 by 3. So it is actually pretty large. Even though it is not surjective, it is pretty large. And a similar estimate can be found for even triangular group. It's just written like a little more technical because you get more precise bound. But this also says similar result basically for triangular matrices. Okay, so after this, so there is some work with my student Riju Bratakundu. Recently, we have been looking at more precisely, we have been looking at this question from a slightly different perspective now. So the perspective which I want to say is this. So there is a lot of work by Fullman and Wall, McDonald, starting from Wall, McDonald, and in recent time by Fullman and several people. This question is something like this. What is the probability of finding a semi-simple element in GLN, let's say, or in a fix any classical group. So something like that, and you say that what is the probability of finding a semisimple element in that particular group, yeah, or what is the probability of finding a regular semisimple element, or what is the probability of finding a regular element in that particular group. Some of these questions also come from computer science point of view. I mean, you can imagine this is important from that perspective, because origin of some of these problems is for symmetric group permutations, right? So what is the probability of finding permutation with certain condition, something like that. So you can ask analogous question for the matrix group and things like that. So what we were trying to ask the question is that, what is the probability of finding an element which has a root, certain root, I mean, square root or cube root or mth root, something like that. So this is a question which will generalize those results in some sense. So we specifically calculated for GL and Q, and these are of course given involving generating functions. So this is slightly different kind of flavor, where you write a lot of generating functions and things like that. So however, I'm not going to talk about this particular work today. Maybe this would have been more appropriate because there's a lot of combinatorics involved, but maybe some other time in future we can get back to this. So I'll just say here in a few words. So for the group GL and Q and fix any integer bigger than 2, we have computed the generating function for the number of semisimple, number of regular and number of regular semisimple classes, conjugacy classes, and the similar calculation for number of elements, which are mth powers in GL and Q.
So,
or you want to say the other? Yeah.
You correctly said that these would be a great of great interest to this group. are these going to be product formulas?
Yes. So the generating function, we write it as a product of something. You get some formula.
Okay. So yeah, we'll hear from you on this in the future.
Are you going to show us the formulas? Or?
Not today. Yeah, I didn't write anything beyond this, just one slide.
So, but this is on the archive, I suppose.
Yeah, it's there on archive. We can take it as a teaser for
Anupam to give another talk next week on
this. Yeah, we could have it next week.
Sorry, I'm not understanding, Anupam. When you mean generating function, what do you mean? I mean, as m varies, or what is varying?
Right. So as so the generating function will be something like the coefficient of x to the power 1 will give you this number. So that n will be the GLn, n. So the coefficient will be
t to the power m will give you. So what is varying? So your what is fixed and what is varying, or are all?
So let's say the formula will be like. So you want to write like one plus an. Let's say x to the power n. This is some over n. This is notation. Then this an will be a function in Q, which will give you that number for that GLn.
So m is fixed. Capital M is fixed.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And but of course we have formula for all m. So all m bigger than or equal to 2.
I see. And then ans are polynomials in Q, or
these are polynomials in Q, and it will of course involve M also. We are looking at that particular power, and then one can ask many questions here, because that is the flavor of the work in Fullman, that what happens if you take Q tending to infinity, or what happens if you take N tending to infinity, and all that kind of questions you can ask. Okay.
Thank you.
Basically on that. So some of these things we have tried to answer for GLn here more explicitly. So this work also generalizes, basically this kind of work originates in Polya's cycle index for symmetric group. And this cycle index is generalized by Kung and Strong for GLnQ and by Fullman for some other classical group. So they have already written what is called cycle index for these groups. And they have tried to study the limits of this kind of elements, semisimple elements, regular semisimple elements. What happens if I take Q tending to infinity, or what happens if I take N tending to infinity, what is the ratio you get? So they have worked on this kind of, there are a lot of visuals, no? And we thought of trying to ask all those questions if you take power and you work with that set. So of course, probably there are lots of questions here, but is this a beginning in a way that we look at for GLN, GLNQ? So this will of course generalize the results for M equal to 1, which is due to mostly Wall, McDonald, Fullman, and Miller. So let's move to slightly different. In the similar line, we have a slightly different result, which also relates to what I spoke a little bit earlier in the previous slides. So I'm going to get back to asymptotic bounds, the bounds which we were talking about, and a little bit more in the sense of asymptotic. So yeah, I should say a joke here before I forget the joke. It's just 2 months old joke, and it's still the time for the joke. So the joke is this, that I might say several times asymptomatic. Yeah. So the two things are same for this talk. Okay. So this relates to the result I was telling you about, the Charlevoix conjecture, and where you saw some nice coefficients coming. Can we do that kind of calculation for any finite inductive group? And the answer is yes, and that's what I'm going to explain you. So let's take some notation. FQ is a finite field, and K is some FQ bar. This and G is connected inductive group over K with Frobenius map F. G of Q is G to power F, the fixed points of F on G. That gives you a finite group of Lie type. This basically framework allows me to think of G of Q as a subset of G, which a priori we think over K bar, FQ bar. If you are not, and we can look at the, again, power map on G, X is going to X to the power M. M is some fixed positive integer. This map is of course defined over FQ. And then I can ask the question that if I look at the subset GFQ and look at GFQ to the power M image under this map, how big is that subset? So I'm just trying to define the framework. And if you are not familiar with notations of reductive group and this, that, you can just simply keep in mind the two classic examples of GLN and unitary group. Consider the group GLN over K. And if you look at the Frobenius map, which sends a matrix to each entry raised q power, then this is a Frobenius map, and the fixed point will be basically the group GLNQ. Yeah, so this is the this is a good example to keep in mind. And if you take similarly Aij going to Aij to power q, and you transpose inverse the matrix, that's also Frobenius map, and the fixed point will be the unitary group here, UNQ. So once again, I will apologize that earlier I denoted U for upper triangular or lower triangular matrix, and now I'm saying unitary group. So, but now onwards, it is just the unitary group. The U means unitary group here. Okay, so let's set the notation. Let's ask what question. Let's define what question we want to ask. So I set this notation G of Q to the power M RS. That means I look at G of Q to the power M and intersect with the regular semisimple element. Yeah, so it's sometimes it gets confusing that you are taking regular semisimple element and raising power M. It's not that. I'm looking at the image set under power map M, and within that I'm trying to find regular semisimple element. So which regular semisimple elements are MH power? That's the question I'm asking. So that's why I wanted to set this notation to avoid the confusion. And the same notation you can set for semi-simple element, GFQ to the power M SS is going to be GFQ to the power M and intersect with the semi-simple element. And regular elements, GFQ to the power M regular is GFQ to the power M intersected with GFQ regular. So this will, and we are of course looking at the ratio of this with respect to the size of GFQ. So it will answer, basically, if we get any result, it will answer that what is the probability of finding mth power regular element regular semi-simple element or semi-simple element or regular element. Yeah, so this is the question here. More precisely, you are interested in studying the asymptotic values of the following SQ tends to infinity. So look at these ratios. So I also included here g of q to the power m by g of q. M equal to 1, this is obviously 1. But if m is greater than 2, this may not be 1. So we want to also know this quantity, the first quantity. And similarly, all these three quantity, all other three quantities. So there are four quantities. And these are certainly going to be something in Q. I mean, it may not be polynomial in Q, but it is some polynomial in Q by some polynomial in Q, right? And you want to know whether Q tends to infinity, it has some finite value, and what are those values. And you must also say that...
Sorry, are these easy to calculate for SN?
There are answers known for SN. Symmetric group, you mean to say, right?
Yeah.
I think there are known answer for symmetric group. So, I think it is known for symmetric group or an alternating group. So I think I have not included here. Or did I said something about alternating group? Where is that? So even this kind of result will tell you that. But for symmetric group, I think it is more explicitly known.
But this is very general. I mean,
yeah, this is very general. But I think for symmetric group, much better things are known.
And it's just like in terms of cycles, right? All the cycles.
So you have to, so if you raise some power, what kind of cycles you avoid when you are counting, which will give you that?
No, it's just curious if there is limiting values have anything to do with SN.
Okay. Yeah. So we'll see the answer. Let me not hide it. I will tell you the answer right away. So let's fix this notation. So if I have connected reductive group or finite field and m greater than or equal to an integer, then all the four limits are equal, and that is given by this. So you have to take it bit with pinch of salt, because these limits may not be one value. And I will give you an example in what sense I mean by that. So you are looking at this as a set of numbers, and this set of numbers will have some limit points. I'm talking about those limit points. So I'm saying that all limit points of all the sets are same, and they're exactly given by these values, different values. So obviously in this formula, if you put m equal to 1, you will see that this sum is 1, because it is sum of 1 by wt, where t is running over all maximal Torrey. So this thing is 1 for reductive group. So it actually gives you that generalization.
What is this d1, d2, dn?
So I'll explain that definition here. So this sum is varying over non-conjugate maximal Torrey, this sum here. And take a maximal Torrey, non-conjugate maximal Torrey, write it as a cyclic product. So it's an abelian group. It's a finite abelian group, and write it as a product of cyclic group. So this d1, d2, ds will be that cyclic factor, that numbers which appears as a product, cyclic product. And wt is supposed to be this Weyl group in some sense of t. So normalizer of t by t.
So these are actual Torrey, not conjugates. No, non-conjugate. So for GLN, this will just be partitions of N, right?
Yes. So I'll write the, formula. Yeah. So let's look at this by example. If you want to understand this formula, let's look at a couple of examples. Very small order example. So let's look at GL2, the smallest example. There are two maximal Torrey of two conjugacy. One is CQ minus 1 and another is CQ minus 1, cross CQ minus 1, and another is CQ square minus 1, right? And you can compute WT1, in both cases you will get 2. So the formula which I have written here, the long formula, this formula will become this here.
Sorry, what is the bracket mean? MQ minus
1? This is GCD.
Oh.
So this bracket M comma D1 meaning GCD of M and D1.
Then I'm confused. You said there are several different limit points in that.
Yes. That's why I'm going to give the example first. Let's understand by this example.
Okay.
So let's look at the example first, then we come back to this again and again and look at this this formula. So let's look at GL2. So the formula will be in, for this example will be this formula here, right? This is 1 by WT1 is 2 and M comma, the first D1 is Q minus 1, another D1 is also Q minus 1 here. So M comma Q minus 1, M comma Q minus 1. The second one is 1 by 2 into M comma Q square minus 1. That is coming from here. Yeah. So, and the formula will give you this value. 3 by 8 if Q is odd and 1 if Q is even. So this is what I meant by that there could be more than one value.
But how does that matter? Q is fixed.
Yes. So, but Q is fixed mod what? That is why this formula contains all those values. So when I'm saying Q tends to infinity, what do you mean by that? Because
I see.
It's right. Not going to be 3 by 8 or 1. It's not going to be one number. It is going to be, depends on Q is even or odd. It will converge to that.
Mm-hmm. So there are subsequences basically.
So that's what I mean to say, that there is a subsequence which will converge to this. There is another subsequence which will converge to that.
Mm-hmm.
But each subsequence in all the four will converge to the same thing. All these four quantities, and all those values are also achieved in all four cases, which is not something very difficult. I'm just telling that.
Okay, so the theorem is stronger. I mean, your result is stronger than what you have written in some sense.
Yeah,
you're saying so, along each subsequence there's convergence.
There we can.
Or all those four.
Yeah.
Okay, and they're equal.
So yeah, so this notation sometimes can be confusing. Limit Q tending to infinity. So it's not one convergence sequence. You have to take subsequential limits. And it only depends on Q mod M in some sense, which is what the example also here suggests. So if M equal to 2. You get two values, M equal to 3, you get these three different values. And that is how generally the general pattern goes. And if you look at the other work where we computed explicitly for GL and Q, the generating function, from that this can be actually read out. It's also independent verification of this result. There we can compute precise number of these squares using that asymptotic formula and things like the generating function and all that. And it is exactly this. For if you to look at GL2Q and if you want to look at squares, this will be 3 by 8 of this. So this is a precise value actually, the number of squares in GL2Q when it is odd and when it is even. And you can see the limit will turn out to be 3 by 8 and 1. So the limit will be basically the highest degree coefficient here. Because GL2Q size is divided by Q to the power 4, right? So it will pick the highest degree coefficient. And in fact, using that result for GL2, you can also compute exact value of exact number of regular element, semi-simple element, regular semi-simple element for GL2. And we have these computations. And this also, you can see that it gives exactly 3 by 8, 3 by 8, 3 by 8. And this gives me 1, 1, 1. So
the case of Q even for the semi-simple case, it exactly matches the polynomial, not only the highest degree term, but the polynomial exactly matches.
Yeah, you can think of that as a independent reasoning, because you can write every element as a semi-simple and unipotent, and you will see when it is the same two, that's what I'm trying to say. You will see that all semi-simple elements will survive, and that is why the number is matching. If you want, I mean, that is like, you know, explanation for that. Some examples. We also have computed for M equal to 3. Of course, if you want to do more than 3, it becomes very large because you are generating function, you are trying to compute the coefficient and things like that. But for M equal to 3 can be also computed somewhat easily, and we get these three values. Even the precise number of cubes are also calculated for semi-simple, regular, and regular semi-simple. And they also give you the same coefficient. You can see that it all matches in each of the case, which is what this result also predicts here. So how much time I have? It's already time. So I just wanted to give some idea about the proof, but what should I do? I think it's already 11.
I guess you can go on a little longer. If people have other appointments and so on, they can certainly feel free to.
Maybe 10 minutes. I mean, I'll just briefly wanted to say the idea involved and not much detail. So it will be like 10 minutes and people are interested in listening. They can be here. We don't see who are leaving, so it's fine. It's not a classroom. So for this part of the thing, I wanted to briefly say what kind of ideas are involved in this proof. So it's something not very difficult. I mean, some very basic, well-known things are involved in this. And so the result, just recall that we wanted to prove that all these four quantities are same and they take this value. And so we have to understand the maximal tori, etc. in a reductive group, which are somewhat kind of well known, and we want to use them to get our yield. So the key step to prove this is this lemma, and this is a lemma on which everything relies. So if I look at, for example, let's look at the regular semisimple element. If you look at the regular ratio of GFQ RS to the power m, regular semisimple element which are mth power, and the ratio with GFQ. This is given to be this constant plus some terms involving Q inverse. Lower order term of Q basically. So that is why when you take Q tending to infinity, this will not contribute anything, and this will basically give you the value you are looking for. This is the same as what appears in the theorem here. So the lemma is the key thing here. And of course, the sum is varying over maximal tori, non-conjugate maximal tori, and this notation T d1 d2 ds, as I explained, it is a cyclic structure of. And WT denotes just the while rule. So, what do we mean by regular semisimple element? Regular semisimple elements are something for which connected component of centralizer of these elements are maximal torus. This is like definition of a regular semisimple element. And regular semisimple elements are dense in the group GFQ. That is why you want to work with them. It's quite easy to work with them in that sense. And in fact, one can find this very nice estimate. This follows from some work of Steinberg, that GFQ regular semisimple element, their size is size of GFQ 1 plus OQ inverse. This also implies
What do you mean they are dense?
In this sense, in fact, you can take also this as a definition of being dense. So since you are counting number of elements, right? So this is going to be a polynomial in Q. So highest degree Q power in both is going to be same. In fact, the coefficient will be also same. That's what is the meaning of dense here. Does that make sense?
Okay, yeah, thanks. Yeah.
And that is also reflected here in this formula essentially. So you are saying that the highest degree power Q appearing on both sides will be the same. Okay, so for example, for people to know, people who are not familiar with regular semisimple element in the GLM K, if you look at GL in this, the diagonal matrices with distinct entries, distinct diagonals are basically the example of a regular semisimple element. You can keep that in mind. So where do we find regular semisimple elements? So these are some of the things very well known. So I just want to repeat them here. Semisimple element generally always belongs to maximal torus. So if you understand maximal tori, you can understand things about semisimple element. And regular semisimple elements are the one who belong to unique maximal torus. So if you want to do some kind of counting, it is easier in that sense to work with regular semisimple element. Because, you know, if you want to sum over maximal tori, like, you know, there is no problem of duplicacy then. For example, maximal tori up to conjugacy in GL and Q are in one-one correspondence with the partitions of N. And just as an example, if you take n equal to 3, 3 has three different partitions, 1, 1, 1, and 1, 2, and 3. And the maximal tori are given like this. So 1, 1, 1 will give you the diagonal maximal torus, which is the split torus. 1, 2 will give you FQ star cross FQ square star, where like you have 2 by 2 irreducible matrix sitting on the diagonal. And this is anisotropic maximal torus corresponding to FQQ. Okay, that's a B star here. So just an example. So now the thing is that we want to estimate over maximal tori and then sum it over whole thing to get the final answer. So if I so some of these things are just to set notation. So T, let's fix T a maximal torus in GFQ, and which can be, these are general theory that this can be always obtained by looking at NF stable maximal torus and looking at its FQ value. So T bar is there up over K, and then you can think of T bar FQ to be T. And if you want to look at the size of, so this is actually a lemma, it may not be automatic. If I look at the a maximal torus and try to intersect with the regular semisimple element, my claim is that it is, the size wise, it is 2 to the power r plus something of order r minus 1. For GLN, it is quite easy to see because you are looking at diagonal subgroup with distinct diagonal. So it is like q minus 1 to the power n. So the q minus 1 to the power n, highest degree is q to the power n plus something of lower order term involving smaller power q. So you can think of it that way. And if I try to, so now if I, instead of counting the size of T intersection GFQ RS, if I look at T to power m intersection GFQ RS, then it is size of T to power m plus something of order q to power r minus 1. And for maximal torus, because it's abelian, for that power map is like, you know, a group homomorphism. So there it will be, the size will be just order of T divided by these various GCDs. So this is how these GCDs appear, because you can do that over abelian subgroup, which is the maximal torus. The power map is going to be just like, you know, group homomorphism. So this is just the kernel of that map. And where the D1, D2 is explained here, that this is supposed to be coming from that. And finally, now you need to sum over all this maximal tori to get something for regular semisimple element. So that is what you do finally. So you want to look at this ratio, GFQ RS to the power m by GFQ. This can be written as 1 by GFQ, and the numerator can be written as summation over all maximal tori and T to the power m intersection with the regular semisimple. And then this we have estimated already here, and we can try to substitute this value here. That's what we do here. So this is substituted here. And now, so here you are taking sum over all maximal tori, but you can instead of like taking all maximal tori, you can take them up to conjugacy and you multiply by the number of conjugates. And that's what we do in the next step, which gives you finally this formula, the formula which we wanted. I will stop here basically. So, for any question.
Thank you, Anupam. That was a great.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
So, are there any questions? You can just unmute and ask.
I can also stop sharing.
I guess I already asked you several questions during the talk.
Yeah,
I think I need some time to think about these things, but looks very interesting. Yeah, great.
Thank you.
So if there are no more questions, let's thank Anupam once again.
Thank you. And, thank you, everyone.
I'll be putting up the video of this on the website.
Okay, thank you.
How are you on